Maral. I'm a DJ and producer based in Los Angeles. For this record, I really wanted to push myself to go beyond the sound that I had created for Mahur Club. I really love live shows, and I was trying to figure out a way to interpret the Mahur Club sound into a live band sound. And I had talked to some people about jamming together and figuring it out, but you know, it never happened. Tried to figure out how to do it on my own. So I was just like trying to figure out how to bring in this kind of like live band sound into my new work. And that's kind of where the concept of Push came, was me being in a band with my samples. When I'm making a track, I like to let the samples lead the way, and you know, I kind of pick them at random until they start clicking, and then I build up the song from there. Especially for this one, I feel like I let the samples kind of go on longer than I did for Mahur Club. Again, it felt like those vocal samples that I use that are from that album, Abaz, it's kind of like they're the lead singers of the track, and they're kind of these crooners, and it feels like they're these ancient vocalists that are now like the lead singer of a rock band. And yeah, and then like taking something like the Persian ney, which is a flute instrument, and then making it sound like a shredding guitar. I was just trying to kind of take those classical samples and make something new out of them. I thought it would be fun to go through my track Azizaman. I feel like that's a really good example of when that sound clicked of me being in a band with my samples and the band members getting sucked in and out of a vortex and coming out as something new. So for this track, I created a bunch of different sections. Like I started out with this drum section, which I ended up using at the end of the track right here. And the main source sample is this song called Dashtistani from this compilation I have, actually. I think I have the CD right here. This compilation I got that has a bunch of masters of Iranian avaz, which is a type of vocal singing. And for this one, the singer is Jahansaz Dadbeh. I sampled that track a lot for the second half. But for the first half, I sampled this folk field recording from the area of Lorestan in Iran. And I just, you know, I took the track, I just took little bits of it and put them together. One thing for this track is that I layered the drums a lot. I have three different drum tracks going. I have an 808, a 606, which I use a lot. I use a 606 almost exclusively for Mahur Club. And I tried to kind of branch away from the 606 for this album. So I used a lot of this session dry kit for the album because I kind of wanted to get that live drum feel. And I loved just messing around with layering the drums and having that live drum come in and out, but also having this kind of still electronic feeling to it. I messed around
around a lot with delay. Obviously, that's one of my favorite effects. I feel like you can get really emotional with it and showcase all different, like, feelings using delay and, like, how much feedback you incorporate and everything. And this has a very dub feeling to it with the drums and the snare. I'm, like, obsessed with that dub snare delay hit, so I tried to replicate that a bit in this track. And then the track takes a crazy shift after this kind of like more meditative section where I feel like that's when the vortex comes and sucks in the samples and spits them out. You know, the vortex is basically me pitch shifting the vocals using transpose, which I never used too much before this record. So that was kind of like a new thing for me. Also, I was kind of using different distortions for this record instead of last Mahur Club. I used this just basically one distortion amp.
Be an animal, be an evil.
I was so lucky to have the collaborators that I have for this album. They all came about in a different way. For the Penny Rimbaud collaboration, you know, Penny is the co-founder of Crass. Crass has had such a huge influence on me since high school. You know, the philosophy, the way that they use distortion. So I just really, I found Penny on Twitter and I was like, oh man, I really have to send him my album. So I messaged him my album and he really dug it, and he asked if we wanted to collaborate on the track together. So I was like, yes. He sent me a poem and I created the track around the poem, and I sent it to him a couple of times back and forth to see what he thought, and we worked on it together a bit and got it to the final stage that it's at. The Lee Scratch Perry collaboration, that came from an interview that Mark Frosty from Dub Lab did with Lee, and it ended up being this really stream of consciousness interview that Lee just like went off into like a whole new world, and Frosty thought it would be cool to get a couple of Dub Lab DJs to mess with it, either edit or remix or do whatever you wanted with it. So I made mine into like this whole new track, and I was like really obsessed with it. I love the you know, what Lee was saying in the track, so I wanted to include it on the album. So we contacted Lee and we asked if it could be a feature on the album, and he gave us his blessing. And also I collaborated with Sodrove, who's this amazing producer from Baltimore but lives in Los Angeles now, on Sweet Thing and No Type. We went into the Red Bull Studios and we kind of took these demos that I had from 4 years ago and just resurrected them and like reinvented them into these new tracks. And it was kind of the first time that I ever got a chance to make something from scratch basically in a studio. And Sodrove was so amazing to work with. Experimental, like weird, just
kind of non-linear stuff, so I appreciate her kind of taking that time to listen and give me like pointers or just like, you know, just give me feedback. I think feedback's so important when you're growing as an artist. And we both moved to LA and got a chance to start participating in the scene more. We first started with a party in downtown LA called No Rules. It was a monthly party, and I would do the live visuals for it. And ever since then, we've been working together on live visuals, and now finally got a chance to do a music video together.
So this is the Aziz Iman video in progress. I wanted to make something kind of like darker or less rainbowy than the last video, because the last video was about sweet things and this one's a little darker. It starts out like in this maze. So it starts out in this maze and you're kind of going through it, kind of like a video game. And then you run into these different interruptions that are maybe alive, maybe not. Kind of like conglomerations of random objects that you might see in pop culture. And then eventually you make it through the maze after a couple minutes of wandering around, and there's this whole other landscape for the end of the song. Because you're always talking about how your songs kind of like start in one world and then end up in a different world. So this is the other world. It's like a bunch of creepy ladies and butterflies in a pool of water. At some point there are like butterflies landing on their hands and just like bugs flying around, plants growing.
Love it.
On how I approach sound and music making. I feel like there's such diversity here that you can just walk down the street and hear music from all different types of cultures and all of them kind of melding together. Like you have your door open and be playing your own music and have someone driving by playing reggaeton, and it mixes all together to kind of create like this 5 seconds of like a beautiful new song that just exists for that moment and is gone. I feel like I've walked through my neighborhood and heard like really amazing Armenian music, and I've had to like try to Shazam it through the neighbor's yard or whatever. I feel like also the scene here, the music scene, there's so many different amazing ecosystems within it that you can learn from people in the indie music, you can learn from people in experimental music. There's just so many different scenes that you can be a part of and learn from. I feel like especially the experimental music scene here has helped me evolve into the musician that I am now, the artist that I am. I feel like getting to play warehouse shows and getting to see people perform experimental music has been really influential.
I grew up going back to Iran every summer for 3 months at a time. I also lived in Iran for 2 years in fifth and sixth grade, so I was always discovering new music with every trip. I started playing the sitar, which is an Iranian lute instrument, different from the Indian sitar, because I was going to Iran so much. And that experience of being engulfed in the Iranian culture and music every year had such a big impact on me wanting to sample Iranian music and to incorporate it in my own music making. For this record, I sampled a lot of Iranian classical music. For my last record, I sampled more Iranian folk music. This time, I was more focused on classical music just because I discovered this compilation in a music store in Los Angeles, actually, because I haven't had a chance to go back to Iran in a while now. So just being able to explore Iranian music still in Los Angeles was so important to me, and I love the Iranian community here in LA. I also started sampling my parents' tapes a lot more. I brought back a bunch of tapes from Iran and have been exploring them, some just like mixed tapes that my parents made from like the 60s and 70s.
I love the way that Iranian artists incorporate classical and folk music into Iranian pop music, and this was something that this artist named Haide did a lot. I think every Iranian has a really special relationship with Haide's music, and she's someone who's impacted me so greatly, and someone whose music I still find like a very big spiritual connection with. She incorporated a lot of like classical types of singing into her pop music, and that's really interesting to me. You should definitely check her out. I feel like she's like the epitome of Iranian music from that time period of like the 60s to the 90s, which was this amazing time period for Iranian music. And you see the transition from when a lot of people moved to Los Angeles and how coming to America impacted the sound of Iranian pop music, and they started incorporating kind of cheesy 80s synths into it and just like these more American sounds that were really interesting to see, these instruments playing Iranian melodies. First started playing sitar, I learned a lot about Iranian classical music and the philosophy behind it. The sitar is an instrument that's used a lot in Sufi mysticism. They use it to do meditations and to transcend. A big part of Iranian classical music is transcending beyond the notes. You first have to like memorize the repertoire, which is like this ancient repertoire of music. And then after you've memorized this repertoire, it's kind of up to you to play it in your own way. And that really influenced me because I feel like the same thing can be applied to DJing, which we all kind of have the same repertoire of music to choose from, but it's how you play it that matters. In terms of new artists, I feel like I'm constantly in awe of all the music that's being released. And there's so many, but one artist in particular is El Heist, who I feel like every single track she's put out has inspired me.